welcome all of you on behalf of the Wyoming Historical Commission. I'd like to welcome you all to this evening's presentation entitled The Merry Depression. And we're going to find out this evening what that name implies. The Wyoming Historical Commission is a volunteer-based organization dedicated to the collection, preservation, and management of our historical resources. While at the same time we provide research, assistance, and educational opportunities for the general public. And this is an example of what we do from time to time. This is important, I think, or we think, because the plant on 36th Street, the Fisher Body Plant, played such an important role in local history, developing our community. We owe this plant, it's almost like part of our family, isn't it? And I'd like to kind of set this up a little bit with a few pictures, because you can imagine years gone by before the plant came, back in the Depression days. Of course, Grand Rapids was known for its furniture industry, and unfortunately, by the 1920s and early 30s, the furniture industry was starting to diminish somewhat, and there was concern with the Great Depression that we need some more industry here. And of course, this was a time when men were looking for jobs. So fortunately, there were individuals who put their heads together and come up with a plan to bring industry to our area. This is an example of what, in 1922, Wyoming Township, we weren't a city back then, of course, Wyoming Township looked like. It was mostly just parcels of small farms and such. And Section 24, which is the area where the plant is bounded by Division on the east, and Clyde Park on the west, and 44th on the south, and 36th on the north. And at that time, in fact, 36th Street was called Allen Road. But anyway, you might see there's a large parcel of land here that went through this 77 acres and went through several different ownerships over the course of time, but that piece of land ended up being very important to this story. So with that, we can look back and see this is a house that actually stood on that 77 acre property back in the early 1900s. And this is probably typical of the rural setting that that we had here in Wyoming until, of course, General Motors came in and then everything started to change. So with that in mind, we're going to hear tonight something about the people who brought General Motors to our area here and made our area increase and become a better place. I would like to introduce Mr. John Cassleman, our guest speaker. John Cassleman retired from Monarch Hydraulics in 2001 after a 20-year career in the company's international operations. Prior to that, John had done some similar work for Oliver Machinery Company. And in fact, early in his life, during his college years, he spent some time working in the summertime working for the General Motors diesel equipment plant over on Burlingame. So he does have a little connection there. The industrial history of Grand Rapids area is a favorite subject of his, and this interest may well stem from the discovery of the fact that his own grandfather played a key role in bringing General Motors to our area back in the 1930s. This evening, John will share this fascinating story with us as we take a look back to the early days of the 36th Street Fisher Body Plant. And I would, before I bring John up, I'd like to say that afterwards, if we have some time, hopefully we'll have some questions and answers, or maybe some of you would like to tell some personal accounts of your memories of working at the plant. So I'd like to now welcome John, Mr. John Cassleman, and he's going to fill us in on his grandfather and the story.
Tonight, welcome. Thank you for all for coming. And tonight I'm going to tell you, I think, one of the most fascinating stories in the history of Grand Rapids in the Grand Rapids metropolitan area, and one that very few people in Grand Rapids or Wyoming have ever heard, at least since the 1930s and the Great Depression. So let me begin right away. You could write a book about this subject. It's an amazing amount of facets to this story, but I'm going to give the high points tonight as best I can, and I think you're going to find it hopefully fascinating. It was only 5 days before Christmas of 1935 that both the city's newspapers, the Morning Herald and the Evening Press, were allowed by my grandfather to release the news that General Motors had made a decision to build a very large factory suburban Wyoming Township, and that its construction would begin very soon. My grandfather had fed the story to the press a few days earlier, but asked that they keep a lid on it until the appointed day and hour. And so they did, until precisely 10:50 a.m., Friday, December 20th, 1935. Now imagine what a pressure cooker the newsrooms of those papers must have been, trying their darndest to keep the lid on one of the most important stories they'd ever covered in the history of the city. Consider also someone who might have been walking gloomily along Monroe Avenue that morning, when absorbed in worry about the Depression, he might have lost his job or maybe his business, and suddenly he's shocked when a herd of newsboys come storming past him to their corners, waving extras over their heads and yelling to the top of their lungs, "Read all about it. GM to build here. Merry Christmas." My grandfather remarked later that that news jolted this community like a giant bolt of lightning. And can you imagine how fast that bolt must have traveled by a grapevine and party line telephones from its center to every home, factory, and business throughout this city? Well, the Grand Rapids of 1935 was a proud community and a nation that had become weary and beaten down by years of bad news and events. A city that was starved for any sign that things were going to mend economically. But this time, it was not just another teasing rumor. Something was really going to happen, and it was going to happen soon. Some were saying they wished it meant they could return to the life they enjoyed before the year 1930. Now, who was my grandfather, and what did he have to do with General Motors and his coming to Wyoming Township? To explain that, let me take you back a few years at this point. Share some snapshots of Grand Rapids as it appeared through most of the fateful year, 1929. It was that year my grandfather, John R. Cassleman, was hired by what was then known as the Grand Rapids Association of Commerce. Some years later, it became the Grand Rapids Chamber of Commerce. And he began to work for the association on November 15, 1929, as its industrial commissioner. Now, that was only 2 weeks after the stock market crash, ominously known since as Black Tuesday, October 29, 1929. Excuse me. As frightful as that day was, no one could forecast on it the misery ahead. Black Tuesday signaled the beginning of a severe recession, as far as anyone knew then. And while history marks it as the end of nearly a decade of record-setting economic vitality and growth, it was considered by most of the time a survivable shockwave. That included my grandfather, who'd lost much of what he'd owned during that commodity crash of 1920 and 21. An economist called that a depression. But the economy healed quickly from it and produced nearly a decade of unparalleled good life for most everyone. People were asking then, after the crash, was it going to be the same this time? In 1929, Grand Rapids was a city of about 170,000 people. Its metro area, consisting of the city proper, its two suburbs of Granville and East Grand Rapids, and the rural and village population of Kent County, numbered about 250,000. Both those statistics had actually grown over the previous decade at a very healthy rate of 22% for the city and 43% for the metro area. Those percentages were, in fact, above the state and national average. Despite that, there were a number of prominent members of the business community who didn't think the growth rate was fast enough. And they relentlessly pressured the Association of Commerce to step up its efforts to attract new companies to the city and to do more to stimulate the growth of its industrial and commercial base at a much faster clip. Lee Burst, the secretary of the association, then candidly described the criticism they were taking by the local press as a savaging. So the pressure was really on. In 1929, Grand Rapids proudly held the title Furniture Capital of the World. In 1929, there were approximately 72 companies devoted to furniture manufacturing in Grand Rapids. Their plants employed about 12,000 workers and sustained whole neighborhoods that had grown up around some of the larger factories. However, between 1926 and 29, furniture production nationally had declined to about 86% of what it had been between the years 1923 and 25. And while the American consumer's disposable income to that time had never been higher, many apparently decided about that time to spend it on a new GM Roadster or a newfangled phonograph machine, a radio, or some hot stocks rather than a sofa for their living room. And so there developed a growing unease in the Grand Rapids business community about this and another threatening factor that had persistently challenged the city's title through most of the 1920s. That other factor was the furniture manufacturers that had located in High Point, North Carolina, and the area nearby known as the Piedmont Triad. And they had gained a disturbingly large share of the market for low to medium end product. Berkey and Gay, for example, the largest manufacturer in Grand Rapids with over 2,000 employees, had bet heavily on their role in that market by expanding rapidly between 1925 and 29. They went from to 5 plants and 1.5 million square feet of production space in that time. Shockingly, late in 1929, the owners had a default on payment of the debt that they had racked up to finance it, and within 2 years had to close their doors and had to declare bankruptcy. Although Berkey and Gay actually survived through the 30s and into the 40s, but in a much diminished role. But the furniture capital is far from being a city dominated by furniture manufacturing in 1929. Its industrial and commercial base was very diverse then. I was particularly struck during my readings about the Grand Rapids of that time by how self-sufficient the city was in 1929 compared to the Grand Rapids of 2011 and 12. That is, just about everything its citizens needed to sustain themselves and even enjoy themselves manufactured here. From the famous Dutch Masters and Van Damme cigars to tires made by Corduroy, and auto bodies by Hayes, which was a direct competitor of Fisher Body, refrigerators and ice boxes by Leonard, paints and varnishes by Guardsman, Heckman Windmill cookies, Bissell carpet sweepers, and Oliver bread slicers and machine tools. The list goes on and on of products made here in the city by companies that were founded, owned, and run by families who lived here. Many of their products were innovative, of sophisticated design, and very high quality, and of not only local, but broad appeal to the national and international marketplace. There were no factories, or headquarters, or divisions, or subsidiaries of large publicly owned industrial companies here. Our industries then were homegrown, and in 1929, they were thriving. On August 6th of 1929, my grandfather gave a speech to the members of a new committee that had just been formed by the Grand Rapids Association of Commerce in response to the savaging they were taking and the pressure that was being brought to bear on them. And that group was titled simply the Industrial Committee. There were 36 members. Many of the names on it you would recognize even today, including Arthur Herpelsheimer, Dudley Waters, Henry Eidema, Paul Steckety, John Heckman, and Robert Irwin of Irwin Seating. Now, they represented a broad spectrum of interests, including real estate, banking, manufacturing, utilities, transportation, communication, and retail. The mission of that group was to consider ways and means to secure new industries for the city and to encourage industries already established here to stay. Now, John Cassleman, at the time of that speech, was the industrial manager of the Kalamazoo Chamber of Commerce. And what he told them on that day was exactly what they had hoped and expected to hear. That is, exactly how to attract new industry to Grand Rapids and how to support existing businesses more effectively so they would not be enticed to move away. And furthermore, he emphasized that competition between cities then to lure businesses away from each other was tougher than ever before. They knew they were listening to a speaker who could not only talk about it convincingly, but had played the game and won many times. All of them were well aware that my grandfather had induced over 50 businesses to move their operations to the small city of Kalamazoo from other cities between 1926 and 1929, and that he'd found utilization for most of the vacant floor factory space there. And he had managed the rebuilding of a decimated industrial base in a mere 3 years. This group was impressed enough by my grandfather and his message that they induced him soon after to move from Kalamazoo to Grand Rapids to take the newly created position of Industrial Commissioner of the Grand Rapids Association of Commerce. And so on November 15, he began a career of service to the citizens of Grand Rapids and the surrounding community, including Wyoming, that lasted more than 30 years. Between 1930 and 35, no major companies relocated to Grand Rapids as hoped and relentlessly worked for. There were some small wins, but for the most part, much of the industrial commissioners and the association's energy was expended and focused on helping Grand Rapids companies with services to weather hard times and to survive the Depression at all. One of my grandfather's fervent goals from the beginning of his employment was the establishment of a foundation that was supported by local businesses and that would provide short-term loans of up to $10,000 to fellow businesses that were struggling through hard patches. He did it, and those loans were in fact still being made as late as 1963 when the program finally ran its course. It was one of many services initiated and provided by the association and its industrial commissioner for businesses of all kinds during the Great Depression. Now, the scarcity of credit to finance new construction was a major obstacle attracting new companies to Grand Rapids. And the fact that most of the vacant floor factory buildings were very old and suited only to light floor loadings for furniture manufacturers. The availability of a single level structures with modern features and designed to support metalworking and flow-through production would have actually resulted in relocation of some major companies to major concerns to Grand Rapids, according to my grandfather, but in fact, that didn't happen. Where we can start here. The bill's gonna now start projecting my guess is about 30 or 40 pictures, starting with the beginning construction of this plant. And I'm going to basically start delving in to what happened from 1934 on and why General Motors began located here. But there's some absolutely fascinating pictures that he's going to project up here for you. And you can pay attention to them or me or whatever you want to do. In 1934, General Motors began to spend $250 million on a modernization and expansion program. And it's centered on a radical change in design of their automobiles. For them, the shape of the roof of a typical automobile was essentially flat, rectangular in design, and utilized a fabric insert on the top. And GM began to gear up for production of a streamlined design that incorporated what they specified as a turret top, T-U-R-R-E-T, top. It was a roof of all steel, one-piece construction. Its appearance was rounded, and one of the modern features that signaled the end of the classic era in auto design. Also, shockingly, GM's automobile sales had soared, despite the depression, from 313,000 vehicles in 1933 to nearly a million by 1936. And it needed to invest a lot of money to sustain that kind of momentum and market share. But to put that in some context, in 1929, they were selling 1,700,000 vehicles. So there was quite a drop, but that was an incredible gain in the middle of this terrible depression. My grandfather approached General Motors in an effort to turn their attention towards Grand Rapids as a potential location for one or more of their new plants, although I have no documentation of when he did that. But Grand Rapids needed a plant of this stature badly, and it was his job, and no one else's in Grand Rapids, to go and get it. On October 5, 1935, what was described as an initial survey of the community was made by GM, meaning they were reviewing the information my grandfather had submitted to them about potential sites and the benefits of our community and its workforce. He remarked about it later that the larger corporations do not locate industries as a result of pleasant conversations or committees of welcome or out of enthusiasm of organization officials. Facts, accurate and detailed, speak louder than brass bands and civic celebrations. And when he made that remark, he was thinking directly about Alfred Sloan, Alfred P. Sloan Jr., the president and CEO of General Motors, who made all decisions based on facts, never on instinct. On October 26, Alfred Sloan Jr., president of GM, and the two Fisher brothers, William and Edward, and other executives came to Grand Rapids quietly by train. They were here to survey the various properties that my grandfather and George Tilma, who was then the supervisor of Wyoming Township, and George Wells, the mayor-manager of Grand Rapids, had previewed and selected as being most suited to a plant of this scale GM was planning to build. Now, there were only three men in this area who directly knew the existence of this project and these negotiations. Not even my grandfather's employer, the Association of Commerce, were made aware of it. The Industrial Commissioner had concealed the project from everyone except his close friend Tilma and the mayor manager Welch and GM officials with the project number he called Docket 1112. 1,112 was the project. That was, he labeled all of his projects by that time, and by 1945 he had over 10,000 projects that he had generated in those years that he worked for the chamber, or for the association. To those he enlisted to work in many facets of this huge project, they only knew they were working on another one of John R.'s dockets, this time 1112. Carlton Caddy, a reporter for the Grand Rapids Herald, subtitled a column he wrote for the December 23rd edition of this paper. Here is the story behind Docket 1112, in parentheses, see your file, a study in facts. And Carlton was telling his readers that if you worked on something for Cassleman called Docket 1112, you will be realizing for the first time when you read this that you were involved in and assisted Cassleman in getting General Motors to come to Grand Rapids. And there were many, many people that worked on this that had no idea that it was going to come out, was going to happen. Cassleman noted in a comprehensive follow-up report to the association in January of 1936 of what it was like to be the single go-between during the negotiations and then thereafter. In effect, I have been the neck of an hourglass, of which General Motors and Fisher Body have been in one big bowl, and the many contacts in Grand Rapids being in the other big bowl. The primary reason concealed in this matter was that General Motors has sworn these three men to absolute secrecy and warned that if any rumors about it were to surface and reach the notice of GM officials, negotiations would be called off and the project would end immediately and for good. Now, rumors, in fact, did develop. Efforts to squelch them were time-consuming and tiring. Sometimes we'd have spent as much as 4 hours a day putting these things out. It only resulted in further pressurizing an already explosively pressurized environment. Some came close to damaging the negotiation, including one in which he was accused of extortion, which may have been an attempt to frighten or coerce him into revealing what he was concealing. And he blew that one off by telling the perpetrators that they were plum cuckoo. One of the rumors, however, my grandfather did nothing to discourage. When someone noticed that boring rigs were drilling for soil samples at the abandoned picric acid plant in Clyde Park in the dead of night, a rumor started that a major oil find had been discovered there. That site was indeed under consideration, but my grandfather let that one fly, and he occasionally, deliberately, sent rigs to sites that had already been rejected for consideration just to confuse and confound the issue even further. But things began to move quickly after GM decided to purchase 77 acres of farmland from Bessie Hanship, a widower whose husband had been the president of Grand Rapids Street Railway System. The price was $25,000 for the tract that was bordered on the north by Allen Road, which is now 36th Street, on the east by Buchanan Avenue, and on the west by the Pennsylvania Railroad tracks. The railroad's location was very important in the consideration of that particular property. Foundational test borings taken on the property November 1st confirmed it was the best site under consideration. On December 13 and 14, negotiations were in earnest about the purchase, and it was made on the 14th. And 5 days later, on December 19th, GM gave my grandfather permission to tell the city what it had decided and to use his proposal to frame the announcement as a Christmas present to GM, from GM to the citizens of Grand Rapids and its environs. And one of the things, right up to the last, they concealed this whole project by making my grandfather a trustee. He held a deed to the Hanship property in the name of General Motors so that nobody would know that, and he also took options on properties around 4 different townships here and in the city, so that nobody would know that General Motors was involved in any of this. On January 31st, 1936, a little more than 1 month later, piles were driven and foundation work in the new plant was started. Over the length of the project, nearly 2,000 local men were hired to work on the massive construction project, and many of them reported to the site without warm clothing or good boots. The clothier, Earl Robson, who had recently started a store on Division Avenue in the nearby community of Home Acres, very quickly solved their dilemma. He, in effect, donated the clothing and boots many of them needed because few could pay him back. Most, however, did pay Earl back as soon as they got their paycheck. Those workers and their families and friends paid the roll back many times with their loyal patronage for generations afterwards. On April 6th, a line of applicants for permanent jobs in the new factory stretched out a mile along Buchanan Avenue, with another line extending all the way to Division. Some men quit their existing jobs to stand in line that day, praying he would be among the 2,000 fortunate enough to be hired. A GM job and a better life for a man's family, with or without a depression. The 400,000 square foot plant cost General Motors $7 million. It was state of the art and the largest of its kind in the GM system. The presses installed May 14th were among the largest in the world. They extended two stories below ground and four stories above it. Those presses began to produce turret tops by the end of May, and the first railroad carload of them was consigned to the Pennsylvania Railroad on June 1st. By December 1 of 1936, short of a year from the date the Christmas present was delivered, 2,100 employees were working in that plant. 85 to 90 carloads, a full train load, were being shipped from it almost daily. The benefits immediately accruing from the establishment of the massive plant to the small communities near the plant and Grand Rapids itself were specified in the front page Grand Rapids Press article dated January 1, 1936. And this shows you the impact this plant had on everything around here. Number one was marked employment gains and a terrific blow delivered to unemployment in this area. Two, development of related industries to expand the benefits of the General Motors location. Three, a boom in real estate and housing and a revival of the building industry that was long dormant. Four, further diversification of Grand Rapids industry. Five, greater volume of retail trade and increase in sympathetic business between plants and local suppliers. Six, increased prestige for the industrial position of the city, which my grandfather used to best advantage a few years later in attracting other large companies to the city. Seven, the bringing of new industrial blood into the community and valuable additions to its industrial officials personnel. That would mean that it attracted skilled tradesmen, engineers, talent in the managerial professions. Eight, the betterment of transportation facilities. During the Depression, most of the railroads here, including the Pennsylvania, had mothballed many of their locomotives and rolling stock. And this plant was a huge boost to all of them. And not only just the Pennsylvania Railroad, but every railroad that serviced the city got a piece of this action. Nine, the expansion of the city in the metropolitan areas, which was what the business leaders of Grand Rapids had been pressuring about. 10, the destruction of negative morale in the community. And my grandfather's logbook for 1937 reflects the beginning of the positive long-term impact on the region that the GM plant no doubt inspired. This is astounding to me. 1937 was a year that was called a depression within a depression. It was a terrible year for just about everything. Employment in Grand Rapids proper increased by 11% over 1936, despite a very bad economic fourth quarter. He also reported that during that year, 27 new industrial buildings and expansions totaling 350,000 square feet were constructed. 13 existing buildings were occupied by new industries and others relocated to larger facilities to handle increased production demands. The Depression's grip on this area seemed finally to loosen a bit for the first time since 1930, thanks in very large measure to the presence of General Motors. At 4,000 square feet, the plant built on 36th Street in 1936 was the largest single structure ever constructed by General Motors at that time. After many expansions over the years, including one as late as 2006, it measured approximately 2 million square feet when it closed in 2009. In 1944, General Motors again favored Metro Grand Rapids with a large new facility on Burlingame Avenue in Wyoming, which most of you know was the Diesel Equipment Division plant. And another in 1954, when GM converted the massive former Haskell plant on Alpine Avenue to an upholstery manufacturing facility for its Chevrolet division. Now by 1970, close to 10,000 men and women worked in those factories, making GM the largest employer in the Grand Rapids area. Now, very few knew that my grandfather's first order of business at the beginning of his incredibly long and busy days was to find a job for every man that was waiting in the line outside of his office door in the morning, especially during the Depression years. Nothing else happened until that was accomplished. My grandfather was known to most of his colleagues as a consummate statistician, financial whiz, industrial engineer, and salesman for the city. There were many different impressions and opinions of him. Yet I remember the best part about him was revealed to me when he and I went to lunch one Saturday in the late 1950s. And we were walking down Monroe Avenue towards his favorite hangout, the Morton House Hotel Cafe, when one man after another stopped him, grabbed his hand, and thanked him again for getting him a good job during the Depression or after the war. And of course, as a 10-year-old kid, I was annoyed. I had these visions of this hamburger and a malt waiting for me. But I look back on that, and that's basically, I learned that, I think, is what motivated my grandfather. He didn't make a whole lot of money. He had to pay, as most of the association members did, he had to pay all of his expenses. He gave a lot of talks to different cities around, and he had to pay his transportation to get to them. He had to pay all of his expenses out of his own pocket for those 10 years. It amounted to thousands of dollars. He was pretty selfless. And when my grandfather celebrated his 25th anniversary with the chamber in 1954, he was credited with inducing 100 new businesses to relocate to Grand Rapids during his career, expanding the area's workforce by a third, which is about 60,000 new jobs, and added $65 million annually to the area's economy. He pioneered the industrial concept that broadened the area's economic structure from one of a furniture-oriented community to a diversified economy based on metalworking. He remained active with the chamber until he was 79 and was a member of an urban renewal subcommittee when he was 83, tasked with establishing an industrial park along Front Street, which is still there. Now, the establishment of the first General Motors plant in 1936, then known officially as the Grand Rapids Stamping Division of Fisher Body, which most of us just called the 36th Street plant, had a dramatic, positive, and immediate impact in metropolitan Grand Rapids during the Depression. Its influence rippled through this community then and for close to 80 years afterwards, like a big, powerful, yet nurturing wave of energy. It will be sorely missed by those who depended on that amazing 1935 Christmas gift directly for their livelihood and by many who didn't. And that's my talk and my story. Thanks for listening. Bill said we have time for questions. We've got to basically exit about 7:30, but either questions or comments, I'd love to hear from anybody who has memories of that time.
Yeah, we have a traveling microphone here. Right, I have a picture there if anyone remembers Earl Robson. John was talking about Earl Robson was a very important part of supplying shoes and uniforms and things like that, work clothes to the early work plan. So we wanted to make sure we got a picture of that. There's a few pictures here I'm going to run through. show the...
Area of building, they're looking at this, notice how empty the area around that, that's the plant. We're guessing that's probably taken in the, you think, the early 1940s, just by the looks of the cars, I think, and the number of expansions by that time. But look at the vast area, which is now all filled with houses and gas stations and everything else. Absolutely amazing what that plant did. Yeah, they made this plant, what I think Bill showed was a picture of the big 120 millimeter anti-aircraft weapons that were made there. They were made kind of towards the end, and they were in fact never used in battle. But they also made a 90 millimeter cannon, which was used. And the war effort, they first started making machine or tool and die and fixturing for other plants. And then they got into machine tools, they got into parts of the B-25 bombers, they got into making wing spars of the B-29. Just an amazing array of things that they did during the war effort. A big reason, I think, was the workforce. Both the Fisher brothers and all of the people that worked for General Motors that came here and saw this community commented on that the caliber of the workforce was very high. They liked that. And if you remember, the Fisher brothers were all carriage makers and woodworkers. And most of the GM cars for that time, through the 1920s and well into the 1930s, had a wood frame. And then you attached metal sheeting to it to form the car body. So these people were woodworking people. And I think the Fisher brothers appreciated this was a woodworking community. I think they liked that. They liked, you know, that culture and that skill that was available to them. I sometimes think that there was kind of an interesting parallel between General Motors in those days. Fisher Body was using more wood in the 1920s to make their cars than all of the construction companies and furniture companies put together. They were an enormous consumer of woodwork, of wood products. Grand Rapids was the furniture capital of the world in terms of using wood. It was a woodworking community, and it had a woodworking culture. And if you think about it, the fortunes of Grand Rapids and General Motors kind of paralleled as they approached 1935 and with this turret top plant that the 36th Street was expected to produce. It was a major element in that big change that occurred in their design. And it changed their culture from going from depending on wood to all metal. And Grand Rapids did the same thing, because after the General Motors plant was established, there was a change in the culture of this community. It went from wood, began to go to metalworking. And, you know, 5 years later, after this plant was built, my grandfather brought in what was called the extruded metal plant over in Burlingame. Later became Renner's Metal. And that time was almost an exotic metal, aluminum. They made billets and rod for the Army Air Force, or what they called it then. But the Air Force in those days was associated with the Army. But they were a supplier. After the war, then it became devoted to, production of bumpers for cars, if I'm right. If anybody knows about that plant. At least somebody used to work here. I met one time, but at that plant. But in any case, the culture, manufacturing culture in this city changed almost with the same change that GM was going through. I thought that was kind of interesting. There was a parallel there. Occasionally, by today's standards, it was a miracle. They started at the end of January, and they were pushing product out of there in May. Amazing. And you look at the equipment they were building it with, it's so primitive. You know, some end mixers and things. And the the steam, they were using steam shovels back in those days to move things around. And labor intensive. And these are men, a lot of them were not construction workers. They were men that were just hired to do unskilled labor on these sites. And they probably had a core from the construction company itself that did a lot of the bus work and things. But the other thing that people don't think about was they had to get water and sewer to this thing, and electricity. And my grandfather, after this thing got going, was also very much involved in that part of the project. Also, George Tillman had a lot to do with that, the supervisor, with bringing all that the utilities to this plant. That itself is a huge project. Same question. It definitely was a steam plant, coal-fired steam plant. Now, I imagine that was for generating electricity. And yeah, that would have to be electricity. Can somebody correct me on that?
Yes, sir. Another thing, the powerhouse that developed, that was where your air came from. And your hydraulic.
Okay, the compressors?
Compressor.
To heat the plant was a bonus, because they had to run the boiler anyway.
Yeah, that's right.
But the air, building air was the big thing for what they needed, and all these presses and machinery. A lot of them were air operated.
Gosh. That smokestack, I can remember. Does everybody remember that smokestack? I mean, that was the signature. Just every time you drove down anywhere in this area, you saw that thing. Yeah, there it is. The other thing that was impressive, I'm sorry, yes, was somebody? Yes, sir.
Years ago, I was interviewing Leonard Woodcock at his kitchen table.
Oh, yeah.
He said that Sloan told him that you will never organize the plant in Grand Rapids. And is that true?
No.
Is that what Sloan,
No, it was organized almost immediately, and in fact, the year after, 1937, they had a very militant strike here at this plant. And that was in coordination with the one in Flint, you know, where they took over the factories there, and it was part of that whole thing. And it lasted, it got quite nasty, until the union sent an organizer here that wasn't so militant, and things calmed down. But that actually spilled over to attacking some of the furniture companies. The Irwin Seating Company was one of the ones who the union went after rather viciously during that year. But one of the things my grandfather actually took a lot of criticism, believe it or not, for bringing this plant here. Despite all the jobs and everything that came with it, there was a real fear of big city labor and unions that would be brought in here with this. They all knew it was coming. So part of the reason they concealed all of this until the very last minute was that so no opposition could really get started because of that issue. It was more than just protecting the property options that had been taken so that, you know, developers would not raise the price. That was a big part of it. But a lot of it was also the opposition to the unions that they knew would come in here with that plant. And Grand Rapids, although they had unions, they'd had labor trouble dating far as far back as the 1800s, had never seen anything like the power of the unions that came in here with that plant. So the other thing was the opposition came from people who did not want to change. They pictured we were going to turn into Flint, you know, smokestacks and plants all over the place. And they were still back in this era of the furniture manufacturing. They liked that, you know, skilled labor and immigrant labor that manned those plants, and kind of an old-fashioned culture. Well, they saw it as a threat to that culture. So my grandfather took a lot of heat over the years and a lot of resentment for actually having done what he did in changing the manufacturing culture from wood to metal in this city, believe it or not. Anybody else? Yes.
My one memory of General Motors is
they'd open up the plant for families to go through in the summertime, and it was so loud in there, I thought I'd give my dad credit for working. And of course, my dad wore a hearing aid, and almost anybody that worked there wore hearing aids. And in the summertime, it was infernally hot. It was just like stuff.
I know. I didn't work there, but I worked at the diesel equipment plant in the summer. And I can tell you, I now have the tinnitus, the problem with the hearing because of the noise. I can remember walking out of that plant my first weeks there, and my ears would ring for weeks. It was painful. You know, there was no ear protection. OSHA wasn't around back in the early 60s. And now I'm paying the price for that. I also worked in some sawmills and things, but that was a problem.
Oh, there it is. Yeah. There's the tool.
But yeah, it was, even with the, you know, that diesel equipment plant was supposed to be air conditioned for climate control. I want to tell you, I worked around heat treating facilities that the temperature in there was 120 degrees all the time. And when you had a nice humid summer night, my God, it was just about unbearable. And I thought about the men who worked in those conditions for years. You know, when I went there, I worked there in 1963 and 64. And that plant, I didn't realize it then, was just 20 years old, and I was working along guys who started there in 1944. You know, didn't occur to me then, but it was, you know, now it doesn't seem that long ago, but it was amazing. But I kept thinking, how in the world could you do this for 20 straight years? It was tough, tough conditions, you know. And that's the state-of-the-art, high-tech kind of plant. But it was tough. Yes, sir.
We were all tough back then.
Were you tough? Right. You better believe. Yes, you were. I think it was yes, sir.
The worst part was second shift.
Yeah.
Because in the morning it was cool. The sun hadn't quite come up yet. The windows were all open in the summer, and the presses were idle because they were doing changeovers and such during the night. And then you start production. Hydraulics, everything moving around, gets hot, and yeah. Then by second, it's sweltering inside that place, and then third, it's still hot, but at least the sun's gone down,
yeah.
It's starting to cool off outside, and the heat just going out through the top of the building.
I tell you, I'm researching this thing, I learned an incredible amount about my grandfather that I never knew. You know, as a kid, I pretty much knew him during, he died when I was in college, but, you know, he was just this big cigar-smoking guy and very impressive, and come over and stink at my mother's house for dinner and with that thing. But, you know, I'm just absolutely fascinated by all this, and I would give anything to be able to interview him. You know, or anybody from that era about that time and all the anecdotes he could give me and all the things that he could tell me about what happened. Because I've gotten all of this in public information now. It's, you know, you go to microfilm copies at the library and try to put things together. Now, one of the things I do have and what I'll tell you about quickly is my grandfather kept meticulous notes all through, from the day he started, 1929, all through the 1940s. And he has log books we found in one of my siblings' basements one day. And he kept notes on every year of the depressions. It's like a chronicle of the depression in Grand Rapids. It's amazing stuff. And he kept track of every meeting, every phone call, every thing that he did during that time. And including, there's a book here that I donated the pages to or the Historical Society recently, that also was recently discovered, all the notes he took from December 1st to December 31st, 1935, during all of the negotiations that he was involved with for this plant. Some amazing stuff in here. These guys have it if you're ever really curious about what really happened. The people involved, it's all in that room. Bill's little cubbyhole over here. Side of the library. So I encourage you all, and also the other log books are all on microfilm down at the main library in Grand Rapids downtown for anybody who wants to research, because it's an amazing story. Grand Rapids, compared to a lot of other cities, did very well during the Depression. There was actually a growth in the industrial base here, and employment actually remained quite stable compared to other places. And my grandfather has kept all the statistics and data that actually proves that. So it's kind of amazing. There's a cigar right there. He used to run a business down in Cuba, believe it or not, early in the century. And that's where he got that habit. He was smoking up to the day he died. These things were huge and they're about that long. Yeah. But he lived until, long as he was 80, so didn't seem to bother him.
Thank you
all for coming.